Okay, so hello everyone. It's a pleasure to welcome all of you. I'm Wally Sobiejo, and really delighted to have this opportunity to welcome our community and to really reflect and celebrate some of the achievements of WPI in ATEM. At this point, I'd like to invite our president, President Lori Leshin, to say a few opening remarks.
Thank you, Wally. I appreciate the invitation to help kick off this this discussion and celebration and sharing of best practices. Obviously, it's coming at a time of challenge on the campus as we are grappling with this virus that is relentlessly here with us. But nonetheless, I think it's so important to take the time to pause, reflect, celebrate success, and learn as we go forward. We are more than anything a learning organization. And so I love, Wally, that you do this most every term now, especially to celebrate a term. I think it's so critically important. One of the, you know, if we think back, and obviously we have a town hall later today, and we'll be talking more about sort of our current status and our current thinking and how we're managing the current moment with the help and support of all of you. But one of the things I would just urge us to think back on is sort of that pit in our stomach in June, July, as we were heading into the return of students, and how we had planned and thought through everything, and, you know, tested the building air and rethought every process and every interaction on the campus, and how we just weren't sure how it was going to go. And in fact, as we reflect, I think there's incredible amount to be proud of in how we have handled this unprecedented time. And one of the, you know, among all of the accomplishments, the accomplishments of our faculty and innovating in the classroom and thinking through how to deliver on the WPI promise to our students, no matter what barriers are thrown in their way, is to me incredibly inspiring as I sort of wade through each and every day of dealing with this crisis. Sorry, there's construction going on behind me very loudly right now. And I'm just so grateful and excited to hear a bit more about all of your thoughts and perspectives. I want to just close by saying thank you to our faculty for all you have done, for what you're continuing to do, and for taking this opportunity to learn from one another, to learn from the moment, and you know, we will all be different on the other side of this pandemic. And there is an end in sight, by the way, folks. There is. It's coming in the coming months. It is coming, but we will all be different on the other side of it. And I think some of those differences will be for the good. That in thinking about how we deliver on the WPI promise for our students. So I want to thank the faculty who've all done amazing work here, and you've got a great lineup today. I want to thank our colleagues in faculty governance for the work that they have done in supporting us every step of the way and in making sure that we're serving our students and serving one another well at this time. And I especially want to thank Wally and the deans and all colleagues in academic affairs who have been both, you know, delivering our award-winning and amazing and transformative education at the same time that we're really knee-deep in very tactical management and support of the institution and in trying to keep us going. So I look forward to hearing from many of you today, and also to seeing many of you at the town hall later, where we'll talk in more detail about sort of the current status, the less fun stuff than you will be talking about today. So again, Wally, thanks for having me, and I'll send it back to you.
Thank you very much, Lori. Thanks for taking the time to share with us your opening remarks. We really appreciate, you know, just all the great work that you're doing to coordinate things and to make WPI keep sort of moving forward in a very positive way, in spite of the challenges of the COVID era. And for me, you know, it's been just really encouraging to see the innovation that's come out of this COVID era. And part of what we celebrate to that in research, in innovation, in teaching, is all the different ways in which WPI faculty, staff, students, administration, and even board members have worked together to ensure that this institution keeps innovating to work out lots and lots of exciting ways in which we do our teaching, in which we do our research, and in which we do our innovation in all the disciplines of WPI. And this, of course, is supported by our governance, is supported by our great deans and department heads and program directors, some of whom you will see today in this reflection. And so in this next part, I'm going to introduce Andrew Texera and a number of other faculty that have been really innovating in the classroom, in the research labs, in the theater, in the way we teach music, in the way we teach business, in ways that are truly amazing. And so I hope that in this next phase of celebrations of individual faculty and group faculty efforts, that you will see just some of the exciting things that are going on at WPI that I really believe we must celebrate. So at this point, I'd like to hand over to Andrew Texera for the first of the faculty perspectives.
Great, thanks Wally for inviting me to talk to you. What I'm gonna talk to you today about is some of our innovation in our chemical engineering curriculum for our unit operation course, and specifically making it virtual for the hybrid teaching. All right, next slide. So before I get into it, this is an enormous team effort to make all of this possible, from the faculty, our outstanding technicians in chemical engineering, grad students, and a big push from IT to kind of make these visions that I've had and some of these ideas really come to be. So true team effort, and I'll be presenting on behalf of the team. Next slide. So first, let me tell you what the unit operations course is. So this is the senior lab experience for our undergraduates in chemical engineering. It's a three-story pilot scale facility located in Goddard Hall that has equipment like distillation columns, separations, heat exchangers, that is really that industrial equipment that we want the students to have that hands-on experience of what does it mean to turn a steam valve, to apply heat to a climbing film evaporator, et cetera. So that's a really tactile experience. We want to maintain that for under these hybrid and tech flex plan operations. So what we decided to do is go at 50% capacity. That means for every group that's typically around four students, two students are in lab, two students are remote. And then we infused a lot of technology with augmented reality, high definition, cameras, and Microsoft Teams meetings that allows the remote students to really engage with the lab students in real time. And the key outcome here was we wanted the remote students to stay involved in actually sampling, recording, and being engaged in the lab. Next slide. So what does this look like? If you're in lab, here are a couple of screenshots. The image on the left has a computer monitor, and that computer is running National Instruments LabVIEW software that's automating and controlling a piece of equipment in the background. That screen is also real-time being cast through a Microsoft Teams meeting to remote users that can see everything that's happening that the local users are doing, and has the two-way communication through the meeting, very similar to a Zoom meeting. On the right image, you see two more pieces of technology that I'll be talking about, the HD pan-tilt Zoom cameras and the Microsoft HoloLens 2 augmented reality glasses mounted under the student's hard hat there. Next slide. So the first bit of technology are the pan-tilt Zoom cameras. So these are not just web cameras. These have a 10x optical zoom that allows them, the remote user, to log in, scan around the lab, left, right, up, down, and zoom in with such high definition that they can read a gauge across the room and actually record the data. So that means the students aren't just at home trusting the lab users to run an experiment, they're actually participating in the experiment even though they're remote. And we've outfit the lab with three cameras per floor. I already told you there are three floors in the building, so that's nine cameras total across that lab. All right, next slide, please. All right, so I've got two videos. So go ahead and play the first one. So this is what you're seeing here is a screencast of a Microsoft Teams presentation. So on the bottom, you can see there are some local users, some remote users, and myself, the faculty member that's joined in remotely. The users in real time are typing in and recording data, whether they're local or remote. Other users are performing calculations. And the really cool part is they can then send this to the local user. So now you're seeing a view from the HoloLens where they're superimposing that Excel spreadsheet while students are actually engaging in lab, and everything has this two-way audio as well, so they're able to participate there. Now go ahead and hit the next video. The last piece of technology is using the Microsoft guides. So some of the experiments have this step-by-step guide that walks them through some of the complex equipment and startup and operation of these columns. So here the student is following a procedure that explains how to turn on or identify the steam on a column. And it's a little jumpy in the stream here, but it's very smooth in person. And you can see these holograms are actually superimposed on different parts of the equipment, which allows them to directly engage with a stepwise procedure. The other cool thing is with de-densifying the labs, the faculty can't always be there telling the students exactly what to do at every step. So we've embedded some videos of technicians, of our lab technician, explaining how to operate each individual piece of equipment here. So you can see here, there's cooling water for a condenser, and the student is being directed, this is how you physically rotate a knob and set the cooling water flow rate. And there's audio associated with the video, and they can actually grab that whole card and drag it over and bring it with them and put it so that way they can directly perform that part of the experiment and then move on to the next step. Okay, next slide. Okay, and just to say this isn't ending here. Rob Dembski, who's gonna be speaking next, and I are working on this grant together to do this similar thing for pharmaceutical engineering and workforce development, and this will be coming next summer. All right, and last slide. And just to bring it all full circle, this is a photo of me teaching Professor DiBiasio the new technology of augmented reality, and it's full circle because Professor DiBiasio there with his technology is the one who actually originally taught me unit operation in my undergraduate curriculum. So thank you. And now I'll move on and introduce our next speaker. So we have Professor Rob Dembski from chemistry giving his perspectives.
Thanks, Andrew. It's great that he could start talking about the material that we've been working on together. But I'd also like to thank a number of individuals on campus who've been able to help us through this work. And that includes Sia Najafi and Mary Beth Harity, of course. Without them, they would be instrumental. But if I can have the next slide. I should also note this is part of a longer series of work where a few years ago, we developed augmented reality protocols to teach lab safety in Goddard. And you may be familiar with this room. And these are just screenshots using the HoloLens. The top image on the left shows equipment such as the telephone or exits. And what we built was a program where students could walk around the lab. And in fact, the same woman that was shown with HoloLens in Andrew's presentation is there on the bottom slide, and she can narrate things that are important in the lab. While we originally intended this to be a standalone, with the advent of the pandemic, it's now possible to have this program be recorded or in live person and then have students be able to get the same experience that students in the lab are getting. If I can have the next slide, please. Now, as part of this, it's important to have easy control. And so this is just to remind me that in fact, faculty who are in charge of this program can readily change things in the program to be able to set different equipment at different parts of the lab. So therefore, if there's three exits or four exits, for example, you can put things around the room. And as I noted before, those items count down. So students can walk around and really either in person or remotely gain experience about what is happening in the lab. So we've been pretty excited by this. And in fact, we're really repurposing it from a paper that we had a few years ago. Can I have the next slide, please? But moving forward, we also knew that we wanted to create improved content for our lecture courses. And so for those of you who may be familiar with protein structures, really understanding the three-dimensional structure and spatial characteristics of proteins is very important. And so along with my colleague, Jose Aguello, what we did is we, on the fly, put together a program where students could build their own 3D structures and then import them into a commercially available program called Augment. Now, this was kind of our quick and dirty mechanism to be able to show things. And in fact, this image is really showing, it is off of the program itself. And although it looks like it should be from a computer, the background is really a wall in our house as we were trying to put a paper together. So what happens is students can build these programs, they can share the structures with each other, and then they can walk around them in any location they want to be able to get a better understanding of the three-dimensional structure. In this case, it's a potassium channel, which conducts potassium ions across the membrane. And so what we've been interested in here is identifying those purple circles, which are the actual potassium ions, and understanding how the protein interacts with those potassium. So we found this to be a really effective manner to be able to have students learn how to understand the spatial characteristics of these types of proteins. Next slide, please. However, because we were bootstrapping really an existing program which wasn't intended for protein structures, there were lots of issues. For example, we couldn't change coloring or we couldn't change the format. And so what we've wanted to do is move forward and improve our capabilities and how can we have a new program with what we actually want to do. So fortunately, we have now, right now, if I could have the next slide, and if you could start the video on the right, Claire, who you're gonna see in the background there, has within these last few months been building a new program to visualize protein structures in three dimensions. So what we're gonna see here is, in contrast to before, as you can see highlighted on the left, and then we'll see it appear all of a sudden on the right, these protein structures are essentially being downloaded directly from the protein data bank. We can see them at different sizes, we can see them next to each other, and as she changes the image right now, you can see that she can change the different visualization tools so we can get a better sense of different conformations and how different shapes may affect related proteins. So together, we've been able to have improved both by de-densifying and having at-home learning for both the lab as well as lecture-based courses. Now, having said that, I'm really pleased to be able to introduce the next speaker, Sarah Stanlick from the Global School.
Thank you so much, Rob. I really appreciate it. And we can start on the next slide. So I am here to speak about the experience of the Global School and the challenge of doing high quality project-based learning and advising during the pandemic. So in the summer, our discussion started to shift away from how do we respond to this immediate emergency and challenge, and how do we really take the opportunity to plan for resilience in the long term? So we had a lot of lessons from D-term and from that emergency pivot to kind of work in and consider for our A-term planning. So I'm happy to say that I think we rose to the challenge, and that's not to sugarcoat the challenges or pretend like we're not missing the side-by-side interaction of a campus or the project site, but we did really have an important opportunity to reimagine some of our work. Next slide, please. So, and I wanna say that staff, faculty, and students are all making this transition possible. In the following few slides, I wanna highlight these three variables that have influenced our success, both in the emergency turn that happened in D term, but then also the effective planning and execution of A term. And those things really are around community support and community assets, kind of a culture of experimentation that WPI already has in its very nature, and then a bit about improving student agency and empowerment. So next slide, please. So for us in the Global School, community building and sustaining came in two ways. First, internal community building and creating new support systems and opportunities to gather virtually and to share knowledge. And then the second piece of this was external maintenance and leveraging of kind of our existing community networks and partnerships that have been built over, in some cases, decades. So internally, we were intentional about making space for sharing knowledge, ideas, and innovations on our teaching and advising. Ruth McHugh and Laura Roberts have hosted weekly programs to connect everybody who is teaching ID 2050 and who are advising to be able to share stories, ideas, and opportunities. The Morgan Center created a faculty online learning community, which many of you have interacted with in really important ways, where we can share ideas and challenges. I have a call out for SketchUp tutorials because I have a project team that needs that support system that didn't have that skill set. So by being able to reach out to folks within our WPI community, within our global school community, we've really been able to innovate in ways that I think have been powerful and have helped really shape new innovations for the ways in which we're doing advising. Externally, sponsors rose to the occasion too. And they've been really more accessible and flexible and understanding in this pandemic times. So Professor Dominic Golding has spoke to me about the importance of, quote, real live sponsors, the ones who are committed. So in some cases, we needed to pivot to different projects to maybe not the sponsors that we've had in the past. But for the ones who have stayed on, and that has been a majority, the folks that we're working with have been particularly strong in connecting and continuing on the partnerships. So he mentioned that it's been a smoother transition for one team, which is the Nantucket team, because the sponsors have been so invested and the students have been able to develop a similar sense of loyalty to their sponsors that they would in their in-person connections. Next slide, please. I also want to talk a bit about a culture of experimentation and dedication to high quality pedagogy. So another reason we've been able to pivot is just because this is baked into who we are as WPI. And that tech flex term has really challenged us in interesting ways. And one highlight that I wanted to bring forward was Professor Courtney Kurlanska's GPS course, which adopted a flipped classroom approach. So much of the content delivery ended up being online with small assignments, quizzes, preparatory information to make most of that in-class time. You know, meetings that were actually in person and together were made more meaningful because they were supposed to be focused on engaged, project-based and group-based activities. So while half the class was meeting, you know, due to social distancing, the others were working with PLAs during office hours to get really intentional and individualized feedback and insight on their work. And then students are doing presentations throughout the entire term with briefings that are constructively critiqued by their classmates. So Courtney redesigned her course to keep the goals of GPS in the front view. Team skills, critical thinking, ability to understand and evaluate global wicked problems, and building individual agency. And so her example, as well as the lessons shared by colleagues across the global school, helped me reconceptualize what ID 2050 has been in the B term. So making most of that time that we're live and synchronous and putting a lot of the content delivery online that the students can kind of grapple with and take in at their own time and space. Next slide, please. And then this final example I wanted to give is we were successful in the pivot because we also have students who are able to rise to the opportunity and take kind of exercise their own agency and responsibility and drive their own learning. So this has been an opportunity for us to rethink our research mentorship, advising, and the ID 2050 experience. And these students that you see here, I'm gonna selfishly brag a little bit about my early research experience students over the summer, who I've had the pleasure of being able to continue to work with in the fall. So long before the pandemic, the ERIE program is already under the strong leadership of Professor Weeks. And the pivot online just helped us to work more seamlessly and comfortably throughout the summer. So the remote team setup helped with some of the blurring of lines of power and kind of getting us all comfortable with one another. We really could check in with one another and then get to the work in ways that were a little bit more natural and authentic than may have been if we were in face-to-face on campus even. They got to know me as a person. They got to see my cat walk in and interrupt discussions. And so over time, they took charge of interviewing and dictating agendas, opening up new questions and intellectual pathways. And then their work ended up going towards a number of grant proposals, articles, and a conference proposal. So I'm really proud of the way that they kind of worked through challenging circumstances to not only make the most of it, but to also really kind of learn what working in a distributed team looks like. And that can be just as successful as face-to-face. So my final slide, please. So just some big takeaways, I think, from a term for me. Prioritizing what makes the experience unique and meaningful needs to be the thing that drives the work that we're doing. So not losing sight of the learning objectives, making sure that the pedagogy kind of guides where we're going. We have a wonderful community here that would share both their really big successes and their beautiful failures comfortably and with humility. And that type of environment makes all the difference. And ultimately, what makes WPI unique has helped us to adapt to all of these uncertainties of the time, whether it's our willingness to innovate, our willingness to share and to collaborate with one another, or just the insights that we're willing to put out there without nervousness or without fear of judgment. I think our community really makes the difference. So thank you all. And I would like to now introduce Dr. Danielle Cote, who is the Assistant Professor of Material Science and Engineering.
Thank you, Sarah. And that's interesting group work. And I found that, you know, with my research group, we're having similar challenges, I think, that most people are doing. So I'm going to highlight today some of the lessons learned that we have from our research during quarantine and now during restricted lab access. So my research group right now consists of everybody from first year, second year undergraduates through PhDs, postdoc, research professor. So we kind of spread the gamut of what we have. And what we found, and the biggest takeaway that we seem to get out of this, has been structure. This group needs structure. And I guess I would call it more of a scaffolding, where, you know, we create that structure and kind of let them fill in the spaces as they need it. So prior to quarantine, this group shared an office. Most of them, they weren't all squished in an office, but they most of them shared an office space. They work collaboratively. All of our research efforts are incredibly collaborative. So they're used to being together and working together all the time. And quarantine comes, and it was a real shock, as it was for many people. They, you know, suddenly didn't have their colleagues. They didn't have their friends. They weren't physically with each other. And we found early on that we had to kind of create this scaffolding for them. So what we did is we actually created, and you can kind of see here in the schedule, we had almost daily meetings initially, and they were over Zoom, and it sounded like overkill. And I kind of regretted doing it, you know, after the first few. I was like, oh goodness, this is every day. But we found it was very important for the students to stay engaged. They really needed that, not just for the technical aspect. In fact, technically they would have been fine with weekly meetings doing this on their own, but they needed it. They needed it personally. I have a few quotes here that I share from my students. You know, they all admitted quarantine was very isolating, and they really relied on these group meetings. So I think that was something that we did, and that we would definitely continue to do. You know, hopefully we don't have to revert back to that, but if we do, it's something that we definitely found was very useful. We also, like other groups, kind of focused on housekeeping. You know, we created a web presence. We all worked with research librarians at the university and worked, you know, on how to curate our web presence. So, you know, we're very external facing if we want to be. So a lot of them worked on their personal profiles as well as our group website. We created a lab logo. Of course, you know, deeper literature searches. We did create a journal club, which we found was really useful too. So we would take turns finding, you know, journal papers. Initially, it was great because I got to go through that folder on my desktop of read later papers and got through that. So we read one of those. We do one or two papers a week, and, you know, have discussion questions on it, and different students would lead each week. And we found all of us actually got some really good insights out of that and led us to some interesting research areas that we certainly wouldn't have had time for prior. I also do show this picture of popcorn. So Harry and David online, you purchased their famous Moose Munch popcorn. Initially, early on during quarantine, I sent some to each of my students, and, you know, some of them were living at home with their parents and some of them were by themselves. And all of them just found that was surprising. But a little gesture like that actually went a long way, because they'd be sharing their favorite flavors and they'd be talking about, they'd be working together, you know, as they're eating it. And I think something small like that, you know, that was a small investment was really powerful for them. And also, since then, I found Insomnia Cookies is local and in Worcester, and they also provide a similar service. So if you want to support local, we have good reviews on those. So that's what we kind of switched to when they need a little pick-me-up. That's something that we did. Also, my group has been really good at finding the silver lining in things. So one silver lining they found was when they're on campus and not a lot of other students are, all of our sensitive equipment works really well. In fact, I got a recent, or just this morning, I got a message from one of my students. Hey, check out how accurate this nano-indenter data is, because nobody's around. We're not getting those vibrations. So they've been really good at finding those silver linings for us. Next slide, please. So this is our new lab space. So this is it's a very unassuming building that WPI purchased on Sagamore Road. It's on the other side of the Salisbury Estates, on the other side of campus. And inside, this unassuming facade opens up to 33,000 square feet of lab space. It is really exciting. So there's three labs that are occupied now, and more space to be finished. And some of it right now is being moved into as we speak. So it's really exciting. It's been a great space. And what the takeaway here was, and I watched this go up mostly during quarantine, which was very impressive. Even after, you know, construction projects stopped for a while, we were able to get back at it. And this renovation has just been amazing and beautiful. And it really took a village. I think about, you know, everyone who helped make this happen and to turn this around. This would have been a difficult task if you saw the before. I walked into the building before the renovations and it was nothing like what it looks like now. It would have taken a village, but then to do it during quarantine is impressive. Between everybody, the architects, the construction workers, facilities people on WPI's end, and a lot, subcontractors, everybody, they really made it happen. And it's been a really exciting space and we're really excited to fill it. And hopefully everyone can kind of take a walk over there one of these days. It's really, really interesting and lots of good space. And besides lab space, there's also common spaces. There's some small conference rooms, offices. It'll be a great collaboration space. So last slide, please. So when Wally asked me to do this, he asked if I would discuss the research that we've been doing and also the new lab space, the Sagamore lab space, and added, but how do you manage to do it with little ones? Well, I'm sure this picture looks familiar to many people. This is staged, but this is truly how days often begin, right? This is what happens. So this is it, Wally. This is what you're not seeing when we're having these conversations. And often blindly, this is how I get through, right? Blindly, if there's ever erroneous emails sent or some major typos, I'm blaming baby Bennett. These guys they make things a challenge. But what really got me thinking is how I'm gonna talk, you know, meaningful about this, and I guess reflecting in this case, is how, remember when we actually used to have a village to raise these kids, to have our family was all part of this great support system of this great village, family and friends and teachers and babysitters. And, you know, not just for family, for dog walkers, house cleaners, we had everything. And now we reduced this village into this tiny little pod, if we're lucky enough to have a pod. So that's been a big jump. And I think that's a big adjustment for everybody. Personally, my pod now, we're lucky to have a pod. It's, you know, my husband and me and the kids, and we still have our nanny and we have our immediate family and one family of friends, and that's it. And it's incredible how much we've lost for support, but we still managed, you know, to get through. And we have the iPad. And I have to say, the iPad has been a huge part of our pod, as much as I don't want to admit it. It's honest. In fact, at the beginning of quarantine, when we weren't seeing anybody, it was just the four of us at home, our daughter became fascinated with British cartoon shows, like Peppa Pig, for all your parents out there. There's several now that she's been watching. And she watched them so much because we just needed to work, right? She was watching them. And now she's developed a small British accent. And it didn't even dawn on me that that was a British accent. I just thought it was how she spoke until other people have said, why does your daughter speak with an accent? So we admitted it. She has a British accent as a result of this. Her vocabulary includes words like holiday and pram and ice lolly. A few months ago, she came into the room and asked where her torch was. I did a quick Google search and it turns out torch means flashlight. So she was just looking for her flashlight, but that's the reality. It's not something I'm proud of for sure, but it's something that happens. And I've heard this story. I've heard similar stories between so many other parents. And I think everyone is doing, you know, the best we can. And I'm happy to be able to talk about it with everybody. And we're just trying to normalize it. I think that's something we can do. So this is another introduction that I'm happy to make. Our next speaker, professor and department head of humanities and arts, Kate Moncrief. She'll be speaking about how they're handling the music and theater this fall. And I wanna first of all, thank you, Kate, for offering your yoga classes through the Be Well Together program. I've participated in them. It gets my daughter off the iPad. We've actually been doing the yoga classes together. And that's something that's been really special and really fun for both of us. So thank you for doing those. And I really hope we're able to keep those up even after this is over. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. Thank you for that, Danielle. That makes me so happy. That really makes my heart happy to hear that you've enjoyed the yoga classes, but it makes me even more happy to know that you're doing it together as a family. I'm slightly choked up. So thank you for sharing that. And, you know, thank you again to Jean King for initiating the Be Well Together, along with my colleagues, Angela Rodriguez and Janine Sirinko, we're there every week. Come join us. But today I've been asked to talk about the arts. So I'm going to talk about theater, but I'm going to share my time with my colleague, Director of Jazz Studies, Doug Olson, who will talk about music. As you know, many of our students participate in the arts. We have creative and talented students who are musicians and actors and technicians. And as you might guess, COVID has required new kinds of creativity to be able to make theater and to be able to make music together safely. So in A Term, the Humanities and Arts Department presented a play, Every Brilliant Thing, by Duncan McMillan and Johnny Donahoe. In this one-person show, the narrator tells the story of her mother's depression and suicide and responds to it by creating a list of everything brilliant in the world, like number one, ice cream, number two, water fights. With the help of the audience, the list grows to include a million brilliant things. I chose this show a year ago, but I thought it was important in pandemic times, even more so. Well, as a dramaturg, I asked the question, why this show, why now? And this show that really confronts challenging times and challenging things and finds a way to get through it seems even more appropriate for us to do. I was the director, I should say, along with a brilliant student team that I'm gonna talk more about. So we had a production team of 19, including electrical and computer engineering major Fiona Doyle, who completed her minor capstone in theater with the leading role. I'll note that this required her to memorize 40 pages and an hour-long monologue, which she did word perfect. both the assistant director, mathematical sciences major Emily Baker, and the stage manager, psychology and professional writing major Emily Benremer, completed their HUA requirement with this practicum. Next slide, please. Unable to rehearse indoors, we moved our rehearsals out of the little theater onto the Higgins House lawn. I never imagined directing a show with a measuring tape in hand, staging each scene, including audience participation at a 6-foot distance. The students showed fortitude, ingenuity, and innovation in meeting and solving the COVID-related challenges that included working safely together, adhering to those protocols in the space, social distancing during audience participation, and the use of individual props. So normally a prop could be handed between people and we could not do that. One student, Arnold Moralt, a robotics and engineering major, was our properties designer. He worked in the makerspace to design audience cue cards. I'm gonna show one of them here, individual cue cards, and props for the audience participants that were then individually packaged and sealed. So you can see those on the chair. Audience members entered the space, the props were packaged on the chair. And then there was a props table, actually two of them for audience participants who would go to the table, pick up the prop they were supposed to use and unpackage it. My favorite actually, let me see if I can show this, was this one, number 992. Knowing to jangle the keys at the wildlife park if you want the others to come out. And he did this in the shape of an otter keychain. And each audience member took their props home with them. A nice little takeaway. Next slide, please. Oh, I'm sorry, could you go back to that last slide? One little comment. Thank you. So you'll see the production team there at the top, everybody masked at a distance. You'll see those lines that we use to help keep us safe, spray painted onto what remains of the grass over there. And then you're also going to see our technical team. That's the quorum. You might recognize that space. So they were able to look outside the window into the gardens and keep a distance from the people in the space. So next slide, please. The show itself was in the tent of the Higgins House Gardens, and I want to give a big thank you to facilities who worked with us on this. This was no small matter to get the space reserved and for them to work with us to share the space so students could study there, but we could also have that protected space under a tent to do this show. And as you saw, the quorum served as our tech booth. The technical team constructed a truss and hung lights and sound equipment. And they didn't falter when rain and high winds were predicted for our dress rehearsal night, our last technical and dress rehearsal the day before we opened. They had to come in and take everything down and return early the next morning to rebuild it. It was a big feat. We worked with our medical advisory board to determine a safe way for Fiona to perform the show without a mask. This included audio support, so not just amplification, but supporting her voice. This was designed by our student sound engineer, Mitchell Jacobs. I'm happy to say the show went off without a hitch. So you can see some photos from the actual performance there. One more little note, as you probably know, Broadway and regional theaters are shuttered. So the theater industry right now is devastated. There's lots of people out of work. My heart goes out to my friends who work in the industry. We succeeded at WPI because of the support, because of the testing, because of the safety protocols, the hard work that we all put in over the summer to try to figure out how to do this safely. We succeeded in producing one of the only live theater shows with a live audience anywhere in the country. Next slide, please. And finally, I want to give a shout out to our two student producing organizations, to Vox and to Mask. The student organization Vox produced Lights Up, an online cabaret that involved 52 students in performance and technical roles, and to the student organization Mask, which presented Love Sick, directed by Katie Duchette. It had 44 students involved in official roles, actors, designers, and technical coordinators. My final note is this was such a joy. I'm incredibly proud of our creative, innovative, brilliant, and hardworking students who are showing that the arts and technology go hand in hand at WPI. Now I'm going to turn over to my colleague, Director of Jazz Studies, Doug Olson, to share with you some of the things we're doing in music.
Thank you, Kate. And once again, welcome everyone to the celebration and reflection of a term. My name is Doug Olson. I'm the Director of Jazz here at WPI, where I direct the stage band, the jazz ensemble, the workshop big band, and the concert brass ensemble. And I'm very excited to share some highlights from our performing groups so far this year, and then a short video. This has been a very unique year in music and for everyone, but there are many successes to celebrate. In the music performance ensembles, we've changed or adjusted in so many ways for safety reasons and to meet the needs of our students. We've changed where we meet to align with safety standards and allow our students to make music in groups. You'll see the concert band and African percussion ensemble in the field behind Higgins House. The stage band, the jazz ensemble, workshop big band and brass ensemble in the Alden Hall driveway and loading dock, and sections of the orchestra at Institute Park. You'll see our groups split into smaller units, rehearsing separately, recording, and then joining parts back together towards a common goal. We've changed when we rehearse to accommodate for changing student schedules, space availability, and lack of sunlight. You may have even heard the concert band or orchestra on a random Saturday or Sunday recording in the morning on the weekend. We've changed what we rehearse to address the challenges of rehearsing split ensembles, recording pieces through tracking individual parts, and adjusting for safe distances between musicians. We've purchased recording equipment to allow for large group recordings outside and individual studio-like recording for individuals so we can hold virtual concerts in the future. We've also programmed for smaller ensembles, allowing for the inclusion of chamber music into the curriculum. And when Mother Nature just won't play along, we move inside to Zoom and have changed how we teach. This new rehearsal format has brought with it new creative teaching opportunities in technology, recording, mixing, conducting, music history, and theoretical analysis and self-analysis of students. We look forward to keeping these practices as part of our future rehearsals when we get to our new normal. So in closing, music is having a great year at WPI. It's a huge part of student life here on campus with over 500 students participating in ensembles alone. I really can't say enough about our students. They've embraced the needed changes and put in the effort to make them work. Their efforts and commitment to their ensembles, to each other, and to making great music are monumental. I feel inspired every time I work with these students, and I know my colleagues in the music department feel the same. In the near future, we look forward to presenting WPI music ensembles in a remote performance or performances, so please stay tuned for that. Right now, I'd like to share a brief performance video featuring the stage band under my direction and the concert band. The stage band will perform two excerpts, one from Symphony and Riffs by Benny Carter, and second, Central Park West by John Coltrane. And then the concert band director, Dr. Mitchell Lutch, will introduce the concert band. I hope you enjoy. Can you cue the video, please?
One, two, one,
mood lighting here.
New faculty member here at WPI and director of the concert band. Due to COVID-19, we haven't been able to rehearse inside this semester, but we have been able to rehearse outside on the lower lawn next to the Higgins House. And with the students' genuine enthusiasm, we've been able to continue to grow and share music and learn and advance the skills of instrumental music. And I'm really happy to share some of that with you now. You'll be listening to Flourish for Wind Band by British composer Ralph Vaughan Williams. Enjoy.
Thank you.
All right, it's my pleasure to introduce Professor Rob Sarney. Thank you.
Thank you, Doug. That was awesome. Wow, I really enjoyed that. So my name's Rob Sarney. I'm a professor of practice at the business school teaching finance and fintech. And I'm going to share with you some of the fun, the learning, some tech flex I've done all during COVID. Next slide, please. So little story here. So I was a first year professor here, and I turned into a video star. I started in August of 2019. That was day one. I'm learning how to teach. I never taught before. So I'm learning how to set up my class. What is Canvas? I had my ups and downs. I'm doing really well. That's awesome. You know, then all of a sudden, right, we get hit with COVID. And that's when I have to regroup a little bit and figure out, okay, how is this going to work? Now, I think you need to hit click one more time. For some reason, the animation's not coming in. There we go. Awesome. So now I have to do this all remote, just like everybody else. Now, how am I going to make this engaging? How am I going to make this fun? You know, and I knew how to use Zoom, but nothing crazy. And I knew how to do a background, but that's about it. So I had a big learning curve. So then my learning went down. But then I said, I'm going to get better at this. I'm going to get good at making fun videos for synchronously and asynchronously too. So let's go to the next slide and you'll see a little bit. You'll see a 1 minute video montage. So this is my greatest hits, what I've done so far, and I'm getting better every time. But then here's a little thing that you'll be able to see. So you can see there was a lot going on there. So I was dancing with Drake. I was in the Boston Garden. I was walking and lecturing as I had a fake cartoon podium in front of me. So I learned a whole lot going on. Next slide, please. And what did I learn, you know, during this? One, I noticed the students love this stuff. It brought a smile to their face during these challenging times. And I noticed, well, you know, when you hustle and learn and try and get better at something, they do the same thing. And this pilot, this test I did, didn't cost much at all. There was no cost for software and very little for materials. And it was a steep learning curve for me. But I don't think it needs to be that way. I think if we really, you know, work together and have some services and have some training, and I'm willing to help anyone who wants to try and do their online video a little bit more. And this actually, in my opinion, this could be, as we already have great professors and we have great teachers. Imagine if we had also great online, and this might be the X factor to really make this difference as we, you know, go more and more, you know, remote if possible, or even, you know, asynchronously. So, you know, and one of my big learnings were, you know, I could probably do weddings and bar mitzvahs now with all my mad video and editing and audio skills that I can do. So next slide, please. So this is what created it all, right? So all it did was $44 to do, get green fabric. I didn't sew it. That is duct taped together. And this is in my basement. It's actually right behind me. You can't see it because I got the background going on here. And it only cost me $44. And I'm still learning new things. I actually just did an asynchronous video for my next class. I'm in Fenway Park. on the grass, and I have my slides moving dynamically on the green monster. So, you know, I think this could be something pretty fun if anyone wants to get involved. Reach out to me. I have some other videos I can show you and get more detailed on the software and everything I did. And just like Disney said, it all started with a mouse. You know, if we get really good at this online thing, you know, we could say it all started with a piece of fabric. So thank you very much. And now I'm going to hand the mic back over to Wally. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Rob, for a great presentation. Thanks to our amazing faculty for really just a wonderful showcase of the different ways in which we have responded to COVID. As we look forward, I want to also commend the role of the administration and faculty governance in so many ways. What I have found is that there's this tremendous partnership that's going on between faculty governance, faculty administration, that is really enabling us to take on some of the most challenging issues and resolve them. And this is only possible through the leadership of our great governance leaders such as Tanya Domenico and Chris Boudreau, Mark Richman, and others that have really worked so closely as we all kind of work to really build out our academic programs. It's also only possible through the role of the deans at Heinrich Kirk, Terry Camasano, as school deans, and our associate deans such as Susie Weeks that continue on a daily basis to work closely to make things happen. And so with that, I wanna kind of invite Chris Boudreau and Tanya to say a few words on the role of faculty governance in the time of COVID. Chris.
Okay, thank you, Wole. And I don't think Tanya's going to be speaking today. Okay. I'm doing this for all of us. And I want to start by mentioning, and I didn't put a slide together with all the names of all the faculty who are serving on faculty governance, but there are over 100 faculty doing this work. Or at least there are over 100 faculty positions. It's possible to serve on two committees, that's the maximum. And some of our faculty are doing that. So I know we're all overcommitted, but some of us are also overcommitted. And we couldn't do it without all of the faculty volunteers. Let's see, so I wanna start, Rachel, if you could advance the slide here, to talk about governance measures that we took for the pandemic. And these started in D-term when we had to go remote. But these are measures to allow us to continue our work uninterrupted. We established the remote faculty meetings, which includes synchronous remote voting. And when we vote next month on another proposal I'll talk about, we will have secret ballots, which is something we were able to do in Olin Hall, but so far have not done. We established a process for expedited action on critical issues. We haven't had to activate this yet, but in case there was an urgent critical issue that came up and needed a quick decision from the faculty and we couldn't assemble the faculty, the elected leaders of all of the governance committees would vote and make a decision, which would then be ratified by the faculty once we could meet or overturned, I suppose. We also implemented electronic elections we've used them now for governance committees and also for search committees for the two dean positions, internal dean positions. And this is something we've long wanted to do because the process of counting ballots and doing runoffs is really time consuming. But we just never got around to it. It was complicated. And I have to give a big shout out to Craig Hsu because he's the one who wrote the code and tried it out. And right now he's making it user-friendly for doofuses like me, but we'll be able to continue this practice once COVID is behind us. Okay, next slide, please. The next thing I wanna talk about are some of the initiatives that we've taken during the pandemic. So I just talked about things we did in order to get us through the pandemic, but we're also working on big issues that are not just about coping with the situation that we have now. Next slide, please. The first one is major progress that we're making toward establishing this tenure track for teaching faculty. And this work started 2.5 years ago. And you know, we took a little bit of a pause at the beginning of the COVID lockdown, but we soon realized we couldn't wait on this. And what, you know, it's been a long time, a lot of collaboration with administration, the board, the TRT faculty, and a lot of discussions with all the constituencies. We're continuing these conversations, and we'll get it together by December 10th, but we will have a faculty vote on December 10th. And what I love about this proposal is that while a lot of the work we're doing is to cope with COVID and to make sure that we're not interrupted with the usual work, which is important, this work has been, you know, all undertaken and not interrupted, all in service of a vision for WPI beyond COVID. So we're imagining how, you know, a big innovation that we can take and really lead higher ed in this country. So I think a lot of us are very excited about this, but it's been a lot of work from a lot of people. Next slide is another major major progress that we're making, and this is for the DIGS department, the Department of Integrated and Global Studies within the new global school, so that new academic programs can be developed, so that all these faculty, including people who are on the tenure track, can have an academic department home where they can function the way other departments, faculty and other departments are functioning. And so this has meant close collaboration with the faculty in the global school, both tenure track and tenure teaching research track, and also with the administration, so that we are in alignment and that the program is in alignment with administrative strategic goals. Next slide, please. Okay, and our governance processes during the pandemic. Go ahead, please, Rachel. We've collaborated with the deans of the schools, the academic deans, in this modified process to select faculty representatives to the Board of Trustees committees. We had a process when this started with faculty reps to the committees. We changed the process last year, a couple of years ago. And now in true Tech Flex fashion, we've come up with a hybrid process of the two, and it's working, and it works because we're collaborating. So now the deans and faculty governance leaders sit down together with lists of candidates, and we talk them over, and we decide collaboratively on an effective slate. And here are the new representative to the board and the current reps that they'll be joining. They had their first board meeting in November. And you can talk to any of those folks about how that went. Next slide. Is there a next slide? Oh, yeah, yeah. Oh, and this is just the regular business that we do all the time. And I guess it looks different. It's differently formatted. It looked really nice and clean when I had the original slide. Sorry about that. But these are the committees that have these 100 and more faculty reps on them, as well as in many cases, staff reps and administrative reps and student reps as well. Okay, and all of the work that gets done here gets done anyway and has continued without interruption. I think Danielle Cote demonstrated beautifully how lives are getting more and more complicated, but we're continuing to do our regular work just in different, funkier ways. Next slide, please. Okay, and then teaching during the pandemic. Go ahead, please. We've worked closely and, you know, I have to say iteratively because it was a complicated thing to resolve, but to secure faculty choice about teaching in person or in a hybrid fashion or all online. And it was complicated because we had all of these different considerations that didn't always seem compatible. But in the end, I think with the president and the provost and faculty governance, we were able to come up with a solution that does take into account the viability of the institution, our financial viability, and well-being, and then safety and peace of mind of the faculty, and then the students as well in their learning environment. Next slide, please. And this, through the CITP committee, has been working on recommendations for digital learning. So with, you know, looking at different test proctoring software and the extent to which it protects or violates student privacy. And these are complicated issues as well. And finally, I want to say, you know, we heard this morning about student resilience and creativity and optimism, but we're also hearing a lot about student distress. And just today, a colleague shared an email from a student who was in quarantine and revealed how mentally and emotionally devastating that experience was. And so again, I wanna just remind everybody that students are suffering greatly. And some of us, you know, a lot of us are aware of some of it. I don't think anyone has a real grasp of the extent of it. And faculty and staff, including administration, you know, are working very, very hard. And so I think we're all, you know, we're all having our own troubles, and we just, you know, again, to be mindful of that. Nothing has stopped and a lot has been added. I think that's my last slide. I want to just say in summation, sorry, Rachel, that to the extent that, you know, we've found the right balance between autonomy on the one hand and responsibility to the institution and to our students, or the balance between continuing all the business that we have to do that we've always done and coping with our new environment and taking on big challenges, big goals that are important and we felt couldn't wait. Faculty and faculty governance has been at the heart of that. And I'm really proud of that. And I wanna thank all of my colleagues who've been involved in faculty governance. Thank you for listening. And now I'd love to introduce my my colleague and friend, Dean Art Heinricher.
Thanks, Chris. I've been mulling this over for a while. I've been reflecting on academics and A-term in this very strange year. And I have to admit that I've been having a hard time celebrating, in quotes, at least not in the sense of a victory celebration. But I am very grateful. I'm very grateful for this community and this WPI family. So as I've been thinking about Thanksgiving more than celebrating, it's brought back some memories. And if you'll indulge me for a moment, I'll try to connect them to WPI. I remember Thanksgiving dinner when I was young. We would go to Uncle Gus's house, and Uncle Gus was a German immigrant. He was a bricklayer. He had left Germany in the late 1930s. I just have to point out that he laughed just like Wally Sobieggio, and he was a bricklayer, so he's a real material scientist. I also remember Thanksgiving dinner with Aunt Mad. That was her name, not a description. And Aunt Mad, what I remember about her was she really listened to you. She really listened, whether you were 14 or 64, she listened to you whenever she talked to you. It's kind of like having a conversation today with Suzanne Weeks. And I remember Thanksgiving dinner with cousins on folded chairs out on the three-season porch when the families were too large. When I walked by the tents on the quad, I remember those days. Now, these memories, you know, they're kind of personal, but I've sparked a few good memories for you, a few sustaining memories. The presentations today have given me some memories that I know I will carry forward. And I want to share one new memory with you, one that came up in A-term for me. And it was when Cert 4 was wrapping up. This was back in A-term, preparing for the transition to the new committee, Cert 5. And Emily Perlow was talking about her experience on the committee, about the level of work, about how hard and how stressful and how consuming that work had been. But she said the following thing. She said, every time I asked for help, no matter who I called, they always said yes. And they almost always did more than they were asked. This has been my experience going back to D-term. It was my experience over the summer when the faculty were building, testing new courses. And it's been my experience during A-term and B-term. And I want to just emphasize that I'm very, very grateful for the family that's come together, gotten us through this, and will continue to get us through this. And with that, I'm going to hand it off to Terry Camisano, Graduate Studies.
Thank you so much, Art. So that's a really hard one to follow. I promise I will not inspire you in the next few minutes. So as a compliment to what all of you have been doing with the classes this fall, I wanted to tell you a little bit about some of the complementary things that we are doing for graduate students outside of their academics and their research. So our graduate students are still very much looking for ways to connect with the community. And at the top of their mind is, what am I going to do when I get through this? So their career and professional development is very, very important to them. And we just wanted to make sure that that still continued even during the pandemic. Next slide, please, Rachel. So everything I'm showing here today is the work of Assistant Dean of Graduate Studies, Rory Flynn. He really did an amazing job of moving all of our programming online, really since March. One of the things that has been going very well for us is that we're doing much better at promoting our graduate students in applying for and receiving the NSF GRFP. So I think our WPI undergraduates are very natural candidates for this. If someone goes to WPI and does an MQP and IQP, they're so competitive when they go to graduate school to be able to receive this prestigious fellowship. For a while, we didn't have very many of our graduate students applying for or receiving the fellowship, and that's really been changing recently, and it's been through a partnership where I'm calling out Catherine Woodington here, but we have a lot of faculty that volunteer their time, that mentor a grad student one-on-one through their application process to make sure they get really good feedback on their application before they submit it. And actually, in the past few years, we've had quite a lot of success. Math has always been a leader in getting NSF fellowships, but we also have them now in learning science and BCB and chemical engineering and in other programs. So that's been very important for us. Next slide, please. I know many of you have probably done team dynamics seminars. We had a very fun program that Rory Flynn organized with Ann Oglefee, where you can tell your strengths and relate it to a Star Wars character. So I think many of us have done this before. And I think with the WPI community, it was very well received to then go find out which Star Wars character you are. So I was really pleased that I was Obi-Wan Kenobi, and I'm going to try to figure out how to use that in my own professional development going forward. Next slide, please. And then finally, we also try to do some fun things with students. So students who are here and students who are not here. As you probably know, we're really proud that we have so many Fulbright scholars come to WPI every year. This year, they were not all able to come in person, and we didn't do our usual field trip to the Boston Seaport that we like to do. So instead, what we did was a virtual event, a recipe exchange. I think the students really took a lot of pride in this. Some of them made videos of themselves preparing the food. And they all had personal stories about what this food means to them and how it's a part of their culture. And I've been having a lot of fun since then trying out all of the various recipes. Last slide, please. And so finally, I wanted to have a student here today so that you could meet a graduate student and hear a little bit from how they're doing. But we have a video of one of our Fulbright scholars, and he just has a very short message of thanks for the community.
Hello, I'm Mohammad Hamaduddin. I'm a Fulbright PhD student at ECE from Pakistan at WPI. I'm really thankful for my PhD advisor, Dr. Brown, and graduate department, Ms. Terry and Dr. Flynn Rory, because of their extreme support, especially when my supervisor left me. So that is the best thing I have at the WPI. I'm really thankful for them. Thank you.
Thank you. And I know that was a little quiet. That was one of our Fulbright scholars from Pakistan. He's a student in the ECE department, and he was just saying how much he really appreciates all of the WPI community. And that is all I have. So now I will be turning it back over to Wole.
Thank you, Terry, for a wonderful presentation. And thanks to all the members of our team that have made presentations today. So at this point, we would like you, if you have questions, to please type them into the question and answer box, and we will try to respond to your questions. I think maybe Rachel or Kerry, if you could help to read the questions, that would be helpful.
Yes, there aren't any at the moment.
But yeah. And then in the meantime, just interest of time, I want to sort of begin just closing this out, because I know we've already exceeded some of our time limits. So the first thing is really to thank all members of our WPI community. For me, this is truly a magical community. It's a magical place where I have found just great innovation, creativity, positive attitude. In a place that I've always said is where I found all the things that I value most in education. And I think you can see from just all the individual responses and the group responses, just how special we are in how we connect to our students, the ways in which we work together as a community, and the ways in which we innovate with technology. I also want to use this opportunity to thank Sienna Jaffe, Mary Beth Harity, and Patty Patria for making all this wonderful technology available to us to do virtual reality and all sorts of amazing things in our classrooms and in our labs and in the ways we engage. But really, hats off to our colleagues in the humanities and arts, and in business, for bringing life into online learning in ways that make me wish I was still in the classroom. Rob, I loved the recreation there, the music videos, the throwback to the last century or so, when I think we were on the dance floor. It was truly wonderful. And it was great to see the creativity of humanities and arts folks under Kate Moncrief. You know, I was at the play and I had my mouth open all throughout this whole thing. And just amazed to see just the level of professionalism and really how meaningful this theme of mental well-being was covered in this play. Truly amazing work. And I want to thank really all of our faculty for making this a wonderful place to learn, no matter what you're learning. And to use the era of COVID as an era to really take our innovation and our creativity up to an even higher level that I think represents part of how we should see the future of education. Now, as we've done all this, the other thing that's also been amazing to me is we have a whole bunch of folks worried about the teaching outcomes and the well-being of our students, faculty, staff, who've done surveys that are now informing the things that we need to do as a community. The real message from this, and this is work done by Chris Demetri, Katie Elms, Kim Le Chasseur, Steve Taylor, Ed Gonzalez, and others, is that we actually have data that really shows us that our community is under stress. And we are. People are great and they've responded, but they're under stress. They're teaching, they're doing research, they're being mothers and fathers and aunts and uncles and caregivers. And so the only way that this works is when we show flexibility and understanding to each other, and we don't put unnecessary added stress to build on that initial state. And so I really urge everybody to continue to be flexible and understanding and supportive, and to really think about the health and well-being of our community. And I urge you all to participate in the yoga. I thought about it, but I was worried about the damage I'll do to my muscles, which are certainly the wrong fixed state. But really, I want to use this as an opportunity to thank Kate Moncrief, Dean King, for making this part of what we do at WPI. I want to thank Charlie Moss and Philip Clay and Emily Perlow and all the folks in Student Life for really contributing in very meaningful ways to the health and well-being of our community. And for John Sambamatsu for raising the issue of student well-being and making sure that we continue to make this important focal point for our efforts. And quite honestly, every time I go for my COVID tests, I'm amazed by the organizational capacity of WPI and all the folks that dreamt this up over the summer. I am totally impressed by the CERT team that keeps us safe and keeps thinking logistically about how we adapt, and the medical advisory board and all the great people such as Gene King and Marnie Hall that bring cutting edge medical information to inform what we do. But I'm truly grateful to the WPI team for getting us this far. And I have to say, for this particular event, really must give total credit to Rachel Roy, our master producer behind the scenes, who knows somehow just how to get everybody together to do an amazing job. As we go forward in the few days ahead before Thanksgiving, I want you to remember the following image. WPI is a bubble within a bubble. What do I mean by that? We are still living through this COVID era, and we have the pandemic raging across the community. And within that context, Massachusetts is doing really not bad, but WPI within Worcester, within Massachusetts, is a bubble. Please be safe as you connect to the world beyond the bubble, and think about all of us within the bubble and how we can continue to keep each other safe. Part of this is practicing things we know scientifically to be correct. Really, do not connect to communities that you don't need to connect to at this time, because that represents risk to your families and risk to us. And as you enforce the conditions that we need to enforce to keep ourselves safe, please continue to really maintain this spirit of innovation, this positive spirit, and let that really be what the students come into contact with, and show each other utmost understanding and respect for the different situations that we find ourselves in. And I'm totally convinced that if we do this, we will get through this pandemic, and we'll continue to celebrate the greatness of WPI in so many different ways in the weeks and the months ahead. So with that, I want to thank all of you for being part of this session. I want to thank really our wonderful, wonderful presenters for their contributions. And I wish you all, you know, happy Thanksgiving, happy holiday season. Take care, everybody, and be safe.